Okay, so let me welcome you to the last lecture on in this Project Roof peer-to-peer framework on social networks. So this will be the last lecture on background information on peer-to-peer topics. We will nevertheless so have still one further lecture. I will say some words on it next. So this is the timeline. Now we are here at the 29th of May. This is a physical lecture, so we are all here, and today is also the submission deadline of the seminar papers. I already saw that some of you submitted already one their paper, so that's of course okay. You have still time until this evening, but I would like ask you to not create a new submission, but to overwrite your old one. So every person should only have one submission slot, basically, and just overwrite your previous structure, because people already have chosen to review your work, and this should be yours, so there should be not 20 new submissions. Okay, once you submitted it, I will do the automatic matching of reviewers to papers, and then tomorrow you will get your email on which papers you should review. The review deadlines are 3rd of June, and we will not meet on 5th of June, but the next meeting will be on 12th of June. That will be the last lecture, and some days later, so on 14th and 15th of June, we will meet in room F0231 and have our blog seminar, where all the seminar talks should be presented. So while you get your reviews, also prepare the talks for your seminars. Okay, so this is the timeline, and for the last lecture, what will be the topic? There we will first talk about the project management, how we will organize the collaboration in the PG with that amount of people, so which tools we will use, and what kind of goals and use cases we should aim at, how we should work together. And we can also discuss, and we should discuss, the peer-to-peer framework. So I gave you this link on accessing the binaries for the peer-to-peer framework to download it and to try it out. I will also write a little how-to, but it's quite simple to use at the end. So set it up in the meanwhile, run the prototype, do some experiments, try it out, and prepare some questions. So for that lecture, that would be quite useful. I also can show you how it looks like, because one moment. So if you download it, so this is the website. There we have the client for Linux, Windows, and I also will put Mac online. And once you have it, basically you will get two files, the program itself. So it looks like this, for example. And there will be also a storage document, a storage zip with pre-established users. And if you open the software, you can log in and use this pre-established information. And which usernames do we have? The user, for example, Alex, and password is password, written small, and then you can try out how it works and what kind of features are implemented. Okay, so for today, I will go through what else is to do. So additionally, what is to do is, if you didn't had your paper bidding, I think it's still possible, but I hope that everybody did it up to now. So choose which papers you would like to review and which not, so where you see some conflict, and here you see also why there should be a resubmission of. So if you upload your paper today or today evening, overwrite your old one, because then the paper biddings are already have been done. Okay, so what will be the topic today? What do I want to talk about today? So last time I sent around an email with all the topics that should be that you should have a look at while I'm not there, and these are basically the topics. And I also gave you the report of the PG of the last semester and put it online in Paul and sent it around, I think. And for these four topics, the content distribution, peer-to-peer file systems, monitoring, and resource reservations, there were individual lectures. And today I want to summarize the most important aspects Yeah, to make sure that really the important aspects are yeah taken like they should be, and that the focus is correct. Okay, so let's start with content distribution and video streaming. The most important aspect about it is about content distribution in peer-to-peer networks is nowadays BitTorrent, and because it's a little different concept than the previous DHTs and online and unstructured and structured overlays. So here we have something like a tracker, which is quite centralized, typically a server, and it's not content sharing. So what it does, it just has the overview on which nodes, which peers are active in the swarm. So what is important, which is also different from previous peer-to-peer overlays, is that you have per file one swarm, so one overlay. And in this overlay you have seeders, which have already the files completely, and leechers, which want to have parts of the file. And this tracker keeps track of who's involved in this exchange. Like I said, seeders and leechers are the other types of peers that we have. Seeders have everything of the whole file, and leechers have an incomplete copy, and they need several dedicated parts of the file. How does the file look like? So as it's important, per file one swarm. And now we look at the file. It's split up in chunks of, let's say, 256 kilobytes. And with splitting up the file in these chunks, you can exchange chunks that you already have and ask for chunks that you still need. So you have this parallel up and downloads at the same time for the same file. And because you have one network per file, it's easy so you don't have to find peers that also have the same file that you're looking for, but you can assume that they all want to have the file and they all have some parts of the file. So it's not like lookup or search in previous peer-to-peer overlays, but it's just which of the peers has chunks that I do not have yet, but they all want to have the same, so it's very convenient. And how do they exchange the chunks? So basically, in this part, the gray blocks are chunks that you have that you can share, and the white blocks are chunks that you don't have. And the tit-for-tat chunk exchange strategy makes sure that you only give chunks to nodes that also give you chunks that you don't have. So there's always a giving and taking at the same time from the same peers. So with that you make sure that you don't have misbehaving nodes, because every node that you give something to has also to give you something back. And how does it work? So first of all, the torrents, all the information about the file is somehow listed in a torrent file. So what does this torrent file contain? It contains the file name, it contains the number of chunks, the hashes for individual chunks, and also which tracker manages this file. And the tracker has then the information which files, which chunks are managed by which peers. So what does it have? So it has all the information about all the swarm, and if a new peer wants to have the file, it contacts the tracker. It contacts it also periodically to get a fresh list of other nodes in the swarm. And what it does, it selects the best out of these swarm list as exchange partners. That means bartering partners. So how does it work? Once you have this peer list, you exchange periodically with them the information which chunks you have. So here you see two leechers, and they have different chunks, and you can encode it basically with zeros and ones and the binary, and it's very easy to encode and to represent which chunks you have, and this you can send around and inform the other peers in the swarm which chunks you have. What is basically the goal is, if you are a leecher, so you don't have a complete copy, you want to fill your empty slots and you want to receive the chunks that are still missing. And for that, you basically have to choose which chunk of that which you miss you have to download next. So which of these empty chunks you want to have next, and there you use the rarest first policy. That means all of the so while exchanging your chunk list, which what you have, and receiving the chunk list of others, you can somehow estimate which chunks in the peer list are the rarest, so which are less available. And that's the one that you download next. With that, you make sure that every chunk stays in the system, and the rarest ones is also filled up, and the rarest chunks do not get lost. So this is the one that you select, that's the chunk. And which bartering partner do you take it from? That we will have a look on in the next slide. So how does this tit-for-tat exchange strategy work? So basically, just assume you have this peer list of the swarm with 50 peers. You take 4 out of them and you give them some chunk, and also you receive some chunk of them. If they do not give you anything, then you exchange that bartering peer, so you do not give them any more as well. So you take them optimistically, give that peer one chunk and expect that he also gives you back, and if he doesn't, then you drop him. Okay, and this set of 4 peers is called a share group, and that you try to maximize on the upload speed level. So you try to take out of the whole peer list, which might be 50 or 100 or 1000, you try to pick 4 out of them which has the highest upload speed to you. And how do you know which has the highest upload speed? That you find out by periodically dropping the slowest out of them. So you keep the fastest and you exchange the slowest and randomly choose a new peer from the peer list. And if it's better, then it's good. And the next time it will be, so the next time you drop the slowest out of your share group, then the new, so I mean you see the principle that you periodically drop the slowest one and pick one randomly, and at the end you have the 3 very good nodes in your share group and one is an optimistically good one. And that's a tit-for-tat exchange strategy, very simple. But you have always keep in mind that's only for one, so BitTorrent is only for one single file where the nodes agree they all want to have it. So I'm not sure in which part this can be really used in the social network. So where do we have the case in a social network that a lot of nodes want to have one single file? Probably if something is very public, and that can be used, but typically in social network it's more one-to-one and there's not a big interest group for one file. Okay, on the chunk selection policy, what I said, so how is it done? Which chunks do you pick? First of all, when you join the network, you say just that you are in the network, and as you cannot offer anything to any node, you just have to wait for this optimistic unchoke that we had in this part. And that's how you get your first chunk. And next time you have something to offer and you can exchange. Okay. Then you use the tit-for-tat strategy as long as you have some chunks. And at the end, you use the end game. That means when only one or two chunks are missing, it's very unlikely that you get some peer in the share group that offers these two or one or two chunks. So it's easier sometimes to just send requests to all known peers and ask them, do you have that chunk? And if you have, please send it to me. And that's how it ends. So very simple. That's the content distribution aspect. So how to exchange one popular file in using BitTorrent. And it's also really used in popular applications like the World of Warcraft updates, for example, where you really have this flash crowds that lots of people want to download one file in a short time. Yeah, flash crowd behavior. Then it's very useful. I'm not sure how to use it in the social network, but it's really a used approach nowadays in the internet. There's the idea that this BitTorrent approach can be modified to have a video streaming. So video streaming is a little bit different than having a file. When you download the file, you just want to have it complete after the download. So once you downloaded it, you want to have it complete. But in a video stream, you want to watch the video while it's downloading. So you do not want to wait until it's downloaded. That means it needs to be modified that you can already play the content while it's downloading. So you have to modify the chunk selection policy. So how can this be done? So basically, you pull, that means you request specific chunks based on your playback time. So you have a buffer. So here you see, for example, the different peers, and this is where the video is played back. And so this is the incoming queue. And what you want to have is basically to have your video that you will present next to the user already downloaded, and it doesn't matter that for the next in 5 minutes the video would run out of content, but you still have time to download it. So what you want to do is to have always your video buffer filled, and otherwise the principle is like in BitTorrent. You have this chunks and you periodically exchange your available chunks. And what is the difference is basically by not having the highest priority first download, not the rarest first download. So you do not look for chunks that are rarest in the system, but you look for the chunks that you will have to play back next. So you have basically two types or three types of priorities of your chunks. The highest priority is that you will have to present next. That's the chunks that you have to download next. That's very important. Then, of course, you can do it in parallel for multiple peers. And you also have a low priority zone for your chunks, which will be needed in a short time. So let's say in 5 minutes. So you prioritize your chunks based on your playback speed. This approach with the video streaming based on BitTorrent is also quite popular. So the video streaming approaches that were peer-to-peer based were quite using this approach. Applying this idea to social networks also a little bit questionable. So this is very prominent, but the question is, where do we have this use case in a social network? So where do we have a high number of users that want to watch one video? So this is, it can be done if we think of something like YouTube on peer-to-peer, but in social networks I've not seen it yet. Probably that's because in Facebook and Google Plus and all of that, you do not have videos played to users on any kind, so they do not offer this. Probably we can think of some nice use case where this is used. Another approach, so this is video streaming for for peers, and what it offers is really to show one pre-recorded video to a high number of users. What it does not offer is something like heterogeneity. So there has been the approach of scalable video coding, which says basically, here I have the same quality video for every user, the same number of chunks, the same quality of chunks. I do not differentiate anything, and that's not always useful. So sometimes you have more or less bandwidth, more or less screen resolution, and there's the approach of scalable video coding, which basically supports it. So with scalable video coding, you have three types of frame rates, you have different resolutions, and you have different quality levels, that means compression levels. And the idea is that you, before you start downloading the video, you first make an additional adaptation that you say, I want to have this quality level, let's say 15 frames per second. I have a resolution of I don't know what, and I want to have compression level 5, whatever it means, so you have more block artifacts. And based on your bandwidth, based on your screen, based on whatever you have, and you only receive the video in this quality. And the next step is to have a progressive adaptation. That means that during the runtime of the video, you can change the quality based on, let's say, the bandwidth that you have. So how does it work? Just to... I didn't put it on slides. But it's just to give you an example how it works is... you do not have one dimension of chunks, but you have three dimension of chunks. That means you have the very lowest chunk dimension is basically the minimum quality. And by downloading chunks in different dimensions that you can just append to your current quality, your quality improves. So the codec is in a way that the more chunks you have for a specific time slot, the better the quality gets. And you can decide on your own which kind of additional quality you want to download. And there you can choose the chunks accordingly. Yeah, that's basically how it works. Okay, this is still in the direction of video streaming, and it's more for improving the quality and adapting it to the bandwidth that one user has. Next, what was on the slides and what is very important is the peer-to-peer file system. So how to store files in a peer-to-peer network. Basically, three approaches has been presented in the slides that I gave you. First of all, splitting files into blocks is a good idea. I must admit it's a good idea once your files are above a specific size. So let's say if you have only files of 10 kilobytes, then it doesn't make sense to split it. But if your block size is, let's say, 256 kilobytes, that's a good idea because then you can parallelize the downloads, for example. Replication is also very good and should be done. And locks is also an approach how it can be how file modifications can be observed. Although I must say to these locks, what we will have an example, and there you see basically that locks are also some kind of pointer structure. So you should not store files at a specific position, but you should always store some pointers at this position so that you can change this pointer later on. Okay, some. According to each of these points, a slide. So splitting files into blocks is a good idea, which is not yet done in the peer-to-peer framework. But the idea is that just is, so that you can load balance easier, that you can assign the blocks to different nodes, and you can download it easier and in parallel. And you can also decide which nodes should store more or less content. So if there's a file, let's say 1 gigabyte, then you do not overload one single peer with it, but you share the load somehow. What is the drawback? And that's why it's also not yet implemented. First of all, it's a little bit, of course, it has more overhead. You also have to replicate more, and you have to search for all these little blocks, and if the nodes are offline, then you have to you have to use the replication, and your requests are always somehow delayed. You need to store somewhere the metadata, so how the blocks are organized and which blocks belong together, and it's also difficult to estimate the size of the block. So how large should the block be? Should it be 1 kilobyte? Should it be 1 megabyte? How should it be organized? It's difficult to decide in the beginning and be sure that it will be good later on. What should be also always done, we also had a lecture on this, was replication. So, of course, because the nodes go offline, the data should be replicated. That's very necessary because nodes go offline and we do not want to lose the data. But what's the problem? How to coordinate lots of replicas? So if content changes or is deleted, then you also have to make sure that the replicas are changed and deleted. So you also have to maintain a structure on which replicas are where and which nodes you used. That's getting complex. Another point is that by replication, of course, you use and consume more storage space. So what is the right replication rate? So what's the right degree of replication? Should you replicate every block 3 times or 10 times? How do you make sure that you do not have too much or too less replication? So there are some troublesome questions and also some solutions which have been presented on the slides I sent you. Erasure codes are some interesting aspect that were already introduced, I think. So what you do there is combining the replication idea with... So this is a little bit more efficient replication, but also has some drawbacks. So in erasure codes, what you do is you have your document. What you create is k symbols, or let's say you split it in k chunks. Out of these chunks, you can create a higher number of symbols. Let's say this is 50 symbols and you create 200 out of it. And these you can store then in the network. And it is sufficient if you download out of the network 50 of these 200 symbols to reconstruct the original content. So here you do not have to make sure that all of them is still in the network, but you have to make sure that at least a certain number is in the network. So you do not have to make sure that the 200 symbols are in the network, but it's okay if 150 or so are in the network. So it's a little bit easier, but also here you see if you change the content, it's getting very messy to change also the symbols and to change the content in the network. So there's always a trade-off of usability, so that you can store and change the content easily and also retrieve it easily, and efficiency. So this is basically going for efficiency by reducing the replication degree. Okay, so on the slides I sent you, there were two file systems basically presented. I want to summarize how they work and what's the main idea behind them. First of all was a cooperative file system, which was by the authors of CORD. And what's the main idea? This is the slide from it. It's basically the user has an entry point, which is the root's public key. The useful thing is by having the public key as a root, as a main key, the signature can also be validated. So having the root's public key, you can check the signature and you can make sure that the one who wrote this document, this item in the network, is also he had the right to do so. So this is in a DHT, and you have here's basically in the upper part, in the upper gray part, is the key under which the documents are stored, and the first document with all following links to directories, let's say, is stored under the root's public key hash. And here you have the pointers to the directories, and the directories contain pointers to files, and the files contain pointers to the block contents. So you see you have a distributed tree that is stored in distributed hash table, and very simple. So basically you have only only content documents and only link documents. That's also something that we use in the peer-to-peer framework, because we also have this kind of distributed data structures with pointers and with content. So this was the cooperative file system. And the other... What kind of operations does it support? So first of all, of course, you can create the first entry. So how do you do it? So you create data elements to store, you create a root item, you sign it, and you publish it. And the block, the content is stored under its content hash. So that means that every content will automatically get a new hash. And the pointers are stored under, basically in the root document, the pointer structure is elaborated, how it points to directories, and that points to files and all that. So it's very useful, but you have only one user, basically only the publisher, and he authorizes and authenticates himself by signing the root block. And this is basically where's the entry point, and by validating this entry, all following entries can be validated. You cannot delete, but the idea of the authors was to you must periodically refresh the content that you want to keep in the network. I'm not sure whether, so this aspect up to the last point is quite useful for social networks. So also in the peer-to-peer framework, we use the approach that you have an entry point for your content, like a user's profile or your albums, and that you sign all your documents that you store. That's useful. The last point, that you have to refresh periodically your content, is a little bit difficult, because what is the right time to keep the content in the network? Is it 1 month? And if for 1 month you didn't log in, then it's deleted. Is it 1 year? How to decide whether the year has been reached? So then you have to synchronize clocks, or I'm not sure whether it's the right approach. Another approach that was presented in the slides is Ivy, and the idea here is basically very similar. Also here you have locks, basically, and the locks are so you have how do I say so you have you can publish content. And what you do is, if this is the content, then you can publish further on changes to that document, so what you changed. Here in this system you have multiple users, and you can also see their content, but also here you work a lot with these pointers. And now I want to go to what kind of additionally aspects have been implemented in the peer-to-peer framework, so what makes it different. So in Ivy and also in this cooperative file system, you see that you have basically one big pointer structure and also data item. And what is typical if you have a multi-user system is, for example, if you have friend lists or groups, that then you also have a list of users, let's say in a group list, let's say listing the members of one specific group, or you have, if you have your wall, then you have the entries of the users. And you do not, if you want to enable somebody to write on your wall or to add some entry to the groups list, you do not want him to change the whole document, but you want him to only add a little piece of information. That means in the social peer-to-peer framework for social network, different operations had been additionally implemented. So let's have a look at the distributed set, for example. So what you can do there, and that's in the project group's final report, is that you, so what is a set? A set is a collection of items, and any user can add new items or delete existing items. So what you do, I'm not sure what this word means. Check should be the word. So what you can do, you can generate a new set, you can add already a list of collection items to it, you can get all items of the set, then you can check for individual items or for an array of items whether it's in the set, and you can delete the whole set, remove individual items, or remove collections of it. So if you think of how this looks like in the in the network, if this is a set that you generate, you can add by let's say add all, you can say add this three items to it, then you say remove, so ABC, then you say remove object C, then only the object C is removed. And what is the nice thing about it? So you identify the node who is responsible for this item, so let's say it has a key in a DHT, and your request to remove C is sent to the node responsible for the set, and the node responsible deletes the entry and leaves the rest unchanged. So that's the difference basically, in contrast to how it would be done typically. So typically, if you do not have the special functions, then you would look up who's responsible for the set item, download the whole item, change it like you want, and send it back to say store it. And in this case, because this is too complex, if you have a list of 10,000 users or 20,000 users, you do not want to get the whole list of users, change it, and it's difficult to check whether your changes are appropriate, and then send it back. It's much better if you really can say, remove this single entry, add that single entry, and to operate on individual entries in the set. So this is a distributed set, how it's implemented. And as you see, the difference is really, you do not operate on the whole data items in the DHT, but you know what is inside, and you operate on individual entries in this item. What is also there is a distributed linked list, which in addition to the set, so what is the difference between a linked list and a set? In the linked list, you have also an order. So basically, let me just think. Yes, so linked list has an order in which the items, so let's say ABC or whatever is in this object, in this linked list, it has an order. So it has not just ABC, but it has the first and second entry and third entry C, and fourth, let's say that's F, and that has an order. So you also have this index. So you can ask, get me the content under index number 2, or set on index number 6, I want to have E, or get me the index where of index of C, that would be 3, or remove index number whatever. So that's more like an array in addition. So it's very useful, for example, if you have let's say walls or something. If you have an ordered list of entries, so for example your status updates, that's ordered, and they would like to set as the next entry your comment or get the comment at a specific entry time and to change it. What is else there is a so-called prefix hash tree. So it's a little bit lots of commands, but I want to show it on the right how it looks like. So prefix hash tree is looking like this. So basically, it creates a tree structure based on the prefix of entries that you got. So here you have that you can think of, for example, the age of the user. So coded binary. So if this is the age of the users, then you, which is encoded binary, then you store under each leaf the user. For example, this is the user of age 0. That's a bad, not good example, but I think you can abstract from it. Or what else could we do? Yes, so just think of this example having a little bit, let's say 100 entries, and you create this tree structure, and under each leaf you create you store the people which have this prefix. So here you see all the entries and all the corresponding prefixes. And why is it good? So what can you do? You can also look up under for a specific prefix all the entries. You can look up and add content or get it back or remove it. But the good thing is that it's all ordered, so you can make range searches. So you can ask, give me all of the entries with which are between this prefix and that prefix. So for example, give me all the users between with an age between 20 and 30. And because this prefix hash tree offers, through linking the leaves in a range search, you can really get all entries in this range. So this is basically the main functionality what it offers. And this is quite useful if you want to really make this range searches. The other aspects like new next, so this is linking basically the leaves, a new previous, or merge two leaves with each other. That's more for internal reasons, but this is how you can use it in a social network. Yes. The last additional data structure that is in a peer-to-peer framework implemented is their group items. And the idea is that you want to have items in the network which are editable by various users. So here, you for example, you want to, for example, what can this be? A group album, for example. And you want to enable all users and all members of the group to edit it. So you can create a new group item. You can get it, of course, so that has a specific key, but you have to say who you are in order to make to enable to check whether you are allowed to see it or not. You can also set, so if you have already an item, you can make it available for a group. You can, and it's all encrypted, so that's how the group data structures are handled, so you can get all the additional keys to it. So I just presented you this four aspects, so distributed sets and distributed linked list, prefix hash trees and group items, because this is how typically the peer-to-peer framework works. So you have on the one side a framework aspect which supports any kind of any kind of data structures like this. So you have the opportunity to, if you have some specific use case in mind, then it's very useful to not only have this very simple just pointer and data structure type of storage, but for your use case, if you have additional requirements like it's for this range search, which is very hard to implement in this manner, or if you want to support groups where you also need additional functions, then it is one approach and one very good approach to really think what are the data structures that my use case, my application needs, to implement it on the framework level, and then following plugins, applications on top can use it. So these are basically on top of the traditional normal storage to make life easier. And especially with this distributed, let's say this this distributed set, this is used quite often for groups. When, for example, I want to register for a group, then I say add. There should be also a single item, so add one single item to this set. And this is my user ID because I also want to be in the group. Or if I want to add a mail entry to somebody's inbox, then I say add my item, which is my message, to the inbox of that user, and then I do not change the rest, but I only append my entry for the inbox. So this is how to send emails. If you have multi-user chat, then you can also say add to the list of chat entries my entry, my current sentence. That's how it can be done. So very useful data structure. Something else that is very useful in the peer-to-peer framework and also in peer-to-peer is monitoring and control of system performance. The reason is, so first of all, what is it? So monitoring means the following. What you want to have is, we have a global system, that means lots of peers involved in a peer-to-peer application. What we want to do is that every peer has some set of variables at a specific time. That means something like the average bandwidth it has available, or number of contacts it has, or average hop count it observed. And what we want to have as an output in this monitoring is to get what is the statistics on these numbers over the whole network. So what is the sum or average or maximum free upload bandwidth, for example. So the statistics should be generated. That's monitoring. And what is statistics? That's aggregatable information. That means if you take, that's an aggregation. So you take a arbitrary number of entries, so let's say 20, 200, 2000 double values, and you put it in a function and get only one out of it. So for example, that you can do for averages, minimum, maximum, sum, standard deviation, that's aggregatable information. Median is more difficult, top 1000 is also not one single value, but we only look for this kind of statistics. Some further properties, so it for you it shouldn't be a matter in which order you aggregate it. So if you calculate the sum out of three values, then for you it shouldn't not matter in so whether you calculate first the sum of the last two or the first two, and then so and you want to also be able to exchange the order, so that should be also so just what typically you would understand under statistics. What should it offer? Yes, get local statistics. So every node should be able to insert its local statistics in the net in this monitoring, and should obtain the global statistics of the whole network. And there in the slides there were several examples how it can be done. Of course, you can do it centralized with a server. Everybody sends their local information to the server. The server calculates the statistics and sends it to all peers. That's very easy. What you can also do, so with overlay specific, I do not want to go into detail for that, because having something overlay specific is very limited, and that's not reusable, and that's not the best. Uniform sampling, I also do not want to go into detail. So that's more like you send out, you do not ask all nodes, but let's say 100 representative nodes to see what's their statistics, and you create the overall statistics out of it. I want to go into detail for gossiping, because that's quite used, and tree-based structure. Okay, so how does this gossiping work? So this is really quite prominent, because you can use it in any kind of graph. So the idea is still that you want to generate the statistics, and in gossiping you communicate only with your neighbors. So you tell them your information, what you know. They tell you what they know, then you aggregate it somehow, and you do this several times with random neighbors, and at the end you get the averages, minimum, maximum, and all that. So just to have an example that we will have on next slide. So how does it work? So first of all, you need rounds, because you do not have it at once. You have to do it several times. You have to exchange information, and that means, let's say you have 50 or 100 rounds. So you pick randomly your neighbors with whom you exchange your information. And after 100 rounds, when no information changes anymore, then you start a new epoch. That means, what is an epoch? I'm not sure whether it's written down. So an epoch is you take your current values and you do not change it until the next epoch. So you take your local free upload bandwidth, and that you use for the next 100 rounds to change, to take a neighbor, send him your view on the free bandwidth in the network. You choose him randomly. It's very small, and you exchange this information, and by time it converges. So this is an example of 12 nodes, and here they want to calculate the average. So this is the beginning, and after one round, so here you see the communication paths, they just, so for this, for example, these two nodes, 78 and 53, they exchange their values and calculate the average. And five rounds later, the values have quite converged, and after 10 rounds it's quite fixed for all of the nodes. And here you see how it converges. And what's this an epoch? Basically, you start with this node start with 78 and doesn't consider the changes of its own local value for the next 10 rounds. So the local changes are ignored, and they notice, okay, nothing changes anymore. So this is the current value, so a new epoch will start. Okay, it works quite good. And just to sum it up, I'm not sure whether I should go into detail how it works. Basically, what you do in the first round, you take your value, so you have two values, SI and WI, that's the weight. So you take your current value, and the weight is 1. And later on, you choose a neighbor, you send him half of your values, and once you receive it from your neighbor, you calculate all of the incoming values. So it's a little bit formal for the algorithm aspect, but I think if you see the example and something like this, it's also understandable how it works. So the other aspects are more for formality. I do not want to go through the algorithm in detail. But what you can do is, depending on how you pick your inputs, so SI and WI, you can either calculate, so this is what you calculate basically over time. So you take your local information SI and another information W, and this is what you calculate over the time, so the average of all SIs in the network and the average of all WIs in the network. So if you, for example, take WI as 1, then you get the average over all SIs. If you want to calculate the node count, then you have to make sure that you have this setup, and you can calculate the number of peers. Basically, you can also calculate the sum. So depending on how you pick your entries, the results will vary, but at the end you have, it's very easy. And also minimum and maximum is easy to calculate. So I mean, if you just propagate your minimum and maximum that you know, at the end everybody will know. Okay, so this is for the gossip based. It's quite useful. The epochs again. Like I said, if you start and calculate the averages, then you do not consider your local values until the end of the epoch. Then you take again your local values as an input and you use it for later on. Okay. The good thing is about this gossip thing, gossip-based approaches, is it works in any graph that's connected. It's quite useful, but on the drawback is it is slow, and you never really know whether the epoch is really ended, whether the convergence is finished. So it's probabilistic that it has finished, but you are not sure. And different to it, there are the tree-based approaches, where you have a clear structure in which the monitoring information is gathered and also shared to all nodes, so that you know exactly that these are the right statistics. So how does it work? So first of all, you create a tree topology that contains all of the nodes. The nodes periodically calculate their own local view, so their local statistics, and send it to their parent node. The parent node receives it. That's basically the parent nodes in the tree receive all incoming messages, create the statistic out of it, and send it to their parent node. So you just propagate it bottom up, all the statistics, and at the end the root has the global view, can calculate it and pass it to all peers again. This is also implemented in the peer-to-peer framework, so this is quite useful. So how does it work? It looks complex, but I'm not sure whether, so I do not think that it is. So what we have to, so how it is working, so here you have the peer-to-peer overlay, that's good. That's Pastry, for example. Then what is done is that all of the peer IDs are divided by the maximum peer ID to have a value between 0 and 1. What is done next is basically to have this virtual concept of domains, and the domain is a range in this interval of between 0 and 1, and the first domain ranges from 0 to 1, and if you go down, you split the domains every time in better parts. So in this time, so the node degree, so every domain is split in better, smaller domains, and you also split the corresponding domain ranges. So here you have the first domain is from 0 to 1. This left domain below is from 0 to 0.5. This one is from 0 to 0.25, and so on. And what is done next? You pick the middle ID, the middle values of these ranges. So this is how it looks like, and this is domain ID. So for the first domain, which ranges from 0 to 1, the middle value is 0.5. And for this range from 0.5 to 0 to 1.0, the middle value is 0.75. Also simple. And you also see that you have a tree structure already, but these are just calculations and values, so there's no peer yet assigned. What has to be done next is to assign peers to these nodes. And how is it done? Basically every peer, let's say this 0.31 node, which knows its responsibility area in PestTree, it can also map it to responsibility area in this range between 0 and 1. Because it's very bijective function, so very simple to calculate. And then it checks, okay, am I responsible for 0.5? And no, he is not, and he's also not responsible for 0.25, also not responsible for this ID, but he's responsible for this node ID. So the position of the peer 50 in PestTree, which is here 0.31 in this unified ID space, so this peer's position is here in the tree. So every peer can calculate it like this. So also 0.9 can calculate it starting from the top, for which domain ID it's responsible for, and it identifies its position. So this is how the peers identify their position in the tree, through simple calculations, basically. They do not even have to contact any node to find it out. They just have to know for which node IDs they are responsible for in PestTree, which is mapped to this unified ID space. Okay, good. So then you have, yes, then you have this mapping, and it's very simple. So the tree overlay, which is from 0 to 1, is easy to map to the PestTree's or free PestTree's ID space just by dividing by the maximum node ID, or by multiplying. So very easy. And because you can check where you are located in PestTree, you can check whether for which positions in the peer you are responsible. And you can also send a message to your parent peer by knowing its peer, its tree ID, and you can calculate with it the peer ID, and you can send it with the key-based routing, so the normal PestTree functions. So for example, if you have a tree degree of 2, that's how it looks like. So you have different peers, and here for example the node, let's say this one, if the peer ID 0.44 is responsible, so it checks whether it's responsible for 0.5, it is not. It's also not responsible for this one, not for that, but it's responsible for this node, so it found its position in the tree. So it's very, so it's easy to calculate. Then doesn't have to be always better children, so this tree degree, because sometimes peers are responsible for various positions in the tree, then they take the upper part, so the highest position in the tree. Okay, so this is how the position in the tree is calculated. Yeah, it's logarithmic, okay. And how is it used then? So now we want to gather the statistics. And basically what is done is that every peer first measures its local status and sends it to the parent peer. So they just locally measure what they have, send it to the parent peer. The parent peer aggregates it, calculates the sum, minimum, maximum, average, variance, standard deviation, all of it, and sends it further to the to its parent peer. So periodically, the information from the lowest leaves propagate up the tree, and at the end, the root has all the global information. Once the root has all the global information, every information from the parent peer is acknowledged down. So so when you send it up to your parent, it also acknowledges that it received the message and sends the global view down. So this is basically how the information goes down. So this is how it's disseminated. So the global view is at the root. Every update message is acknowledged, and the acknowledgement contains a global view from one level above. So information goes up, it comes down, and every node has the global view. And this is implemented in the peer-to-peer framework. So you already have the opportunity to gather statistics on the running system. And I should probably, if you use the peer-to-peer framework, like it's if you use the prototype, you can enable it here with monitoring, so you can start the monitoring, and after a short time you can also view the results and the statistics that are gathered. So this is just a side note. Okay. Oh, that's it. So very simple monitoring, and it's with this you know that really your information, your statistics are precise and that they are in time, and that you have the statistics on the network. So what is next? Next is the idea that has been presented in the slides, is when you know the information and you see that the peer-to-peer framework, for example, how it performs, then sometimes you would like to take influence on the performance. And that means the management of peer-to-peer systems. So what you want to do is in controlling the quality of service. So if you observe that the hop count or the lookup time is too bad, then you want to change it somehow. Because, so what's the scenario? Ah yeah, like I said, social network, response time is too slow. You want to change it. And how can you do it? Because you are one part of 10,000, 100,000 nodes, is basically all of the nodes should be aware of it and should reconfigure themselves. So you want to change the peer configurations of all of the 100,000, 1 million nodes. So how can this be done? So first of all, you need the software needs access to these peer configurations, and it should be there should be a coordinated approach to automatically reconfigure all of the peers. So for example, what you can do is to increase the number of contacts a node has, or to change this and that parameters. And how do you find out what should be done? And it should be done automatically, so you need an automated analysis, planning, and execution. And this is also part of control theory, so there you have similar aspects. So control loop consists of monitoring, analyze, plan, execute. So basically, what is typically the case is if this is the system provider or we as developers, and somebody is using our software, and this is our software, so it has these are our mechanisms, and it's somewhere in the network, and there are different dynamics that take influence on it. So the number of peers changes, the peer heterogeneity changes, the application is used differently. So there are dynamics, and the quality of service is somehow changing. So first of all, we need the monitoring that we have, and the users can see what's happening, and we can see what's happening. And what you want to do next is basically to say how the quality should be. So what should be the response time? And this should be some software. And what should be also done for the control loop is basically to take also not just the service quality, but to also monitor the current configuration of all of the peers, to generate statistics on it, to see what is the average number of contacts per node. And by having basically the current configuration and the current quality, as well as the quality goal, we can think of a new configuration that shifts the quality that's observed into the direction of how it should be. So this is the control loop, basically. And how can this be done? So this is not implemented in the peer-to-peer framework, but there are simulation results for it that show that it would be good. And basically, what does it need? It needs taking influence on the configuration of all of the nodes. So what can be done? So first of all, in order to not to change too much, we want to additionally gather current system parameters and be able to distribute new parameter configurations. So what should be changed? It should be changed that not only the local monitoring values should be gathered, but also the local configuration, so that we generate statistics on it. And next, the root gets all of the information, and it should also push down not just the global metric statistics, but also new parameter settings to all of the peers. So that's how we have everything together for the control loop. So both the current quality status, the current configuration, and how the next configuration should look like. So because everything is in the root, somehow centralized, the root can detect what's going wrong, plan a new configuration, and spread it with the monitoring tree so that all peers can apply it. Of course, it can be also done differently, or how to plan a new configuration. I just want to show how simply and easily the control loop can be changed, can be closed, so with the example of Cord. But the same also applies for Pastry. So if you want basically to take control on the hop count, what we can do, so it should be between 7 and 10, let's say. In Cord, it's the finger table size to modify. In Pastry, it would be the size of the routing table. So instead of having per entry, per prefix, one entry, we could also have more entries to have just a higher set of options to come closer to the destination. And the idea is, so that has been shown in simulations, that the target metrics, so this hop count, can be really reached and held. And it has been simulated with 10,000 nodes. This is the setup for the monitoring tree. So tree degree was 4, update interval was 30 seconds. And this is something for Cord. But how it works, so just to show, so here the lookup, the hop count was around 100, because the finger table size was about 20. Yeah, it was 20. And the network detected itself that the quality is too bad and doubled the routing table size. So doubled it to 40. And then the hop count went down to, I think, 15. But it was still too bad, so we wanted to have it in the range of 7 to 10. And then the network detected again that it's not good enough, doubled it again to 80, and then the hop count was okay. So the automatic adaptation of the configurations of these 10,000 nodes was working, and also this control loop of self-adapting networks was working. Also, the other way worked, so if your quality is too good, just to show that if you are spending too much traffic on your routing tables because it's too good, then you can also relax it. So in this case, we had an initial routing table size of 160, and the hop count was around the average hop count of 5.7. So 10% of the hop of the routing table entries were dropped. And these were dropped 3 times, and after the third drop of 10% of the routing table entries, we had a hop count between, at 7.1, and it was in our metric interval that we wanted to have. So the statement is, basically for this management, is once you have the monitoring, what we have in the peer-to-peer framework, it might be also good to think about how we can control the performance, because once we have the social network running with 10,000 users and somehow the performance is bad, you do not have too much chances to change something in the code or in the configuration if you do not have something like this. So the only option that you would have is to ask the people, please download the current version of the social network and everything will be fine. That's one option, but it's somehow better to have this automated automated reconfiguration of the system to adapt to the current situation. So even also when the users go online, offline, and you have these peaks of users, then the system could reconfigure itself. Or if the users are going to, if it's night and the users go offline, then you also would like to increase something like the replication. And that's good to have this automated adaptive control loop to keep the the system quality in a good shape. Okay, one other aspect that was presented in the slides is resource reservations. And here I want to show, so the resource reservation consists of two parts. First of all, so what does it mean? Resource reservation means you want to reserve in the peer-to-peer network a desired amount of resources, like storage space, bandwidth, CPU power. And it requires first to find peers that offer this, and second to make sure that you always have sufficient number of peers providing these resources online so that you can host some services on it. And next I want to show how to find peers with given properties. So how to have a capacity-based peer search or peer-specific monitoring. So what does it mean? So peer-specific information is something like bandwidth, operating system, Java version, CPU power, storage space, like you see. And the problem is, it is not aggregatable. So if you have 10 peers or 4 peers, you cannot minimize, so you cannot aggregate this information. So the size of the information is growing linearly with the number of users, with the number of peers that you keep information on. And this was not the case with the statistics. So it doesn't, the size for statistics for 10 or for 10 million peers is the same, but here it's growing linearly if you keep information on 10 or 10 million peers. And what you want to support is capacity-based peer search. That means you want to, so to give you an example what kind of resources we talk about, that's for example CPU cycles, memory, system architecture, Java, virtual machine type, number of lifetime of the peer. So these are very peer individual information. And what you want to have it for is to have capacity-based peer search. That means you want to find peers with, let's say, a CPU consumption less than 10% and a storage space more than 100 megabyte. So you want to specify for different capacities minimum or maximum values. I'm not sure whether I have an example for this. No, I don't have, but that's the goal. So you want to be able to find peers with desired capabilities. And that's quite useful also in a social network. So just think of, you want to have you want to distribute a very large file, and you do not have sufficient bandwidth to do it, to share it with all your friends. Then you would like, for example, to find a peer which has the desired storage space and a high bandwidth. To this peer, you would upload the file and he would distribute it. Or you would look for a peer with a very long lifetime so that you know this peer will stay also long online for the future. So sometimes it's very useful. Also, if you want to look for, if you want to run some Java code on some different machine, some remote code execution, then you would like to find peers with given storage space and CPU capabilities and Java virtual machine version so that the nodes can really run it. So how can it be done and what are the problems? So the problems are that really the data sizes are growing. And if we use a tree structure like previously, then we have the problem that by increasing the size of information with every tree level going to the root, then the nodes will be overloaded. The question is, how can the peers be can be protected from the overload. So here you see again the tree structure somehow, and the idea is that every peer in the tree, so we still have this gathering of information going up the tree, and every so the lowest peer just tells its own information, and the parent peer tells the to its parent peer the list of peers it knows, and you go up, and this peer knows then all peers in its ID range, in its domain. So while you go up in the tree, you increase the size, the number of peers that you know about. And in order to not overload such peers, each peer should be able to define a maximum load. And every coordinator, that means one inner node in the tree, should be able to choose a strong supporting peer. That means one peer out of its domain that is able to carry the load. And that support peer should do the work, basically. So in this case, the root peer is too weak, and it asks the support peer to take over the load, and all further load and work should be done by the support peers. And with this, the idea is you still have the problem with overload, but you can make sure basically that only the peers which are very strong are in this tree, and there is no further peer in the network that can take more load. So you have the best tree that's available, and if any further load is securing, you can drop it. So let's see an example. How do you pick the support peer? So first of all, you have these domains, and out of this you can always take the second best for a support peer, and the best peer is propagated to one level higher. And on this domain, the coordinator can pick the second best peer as support peer, and the best peer out of all of the peers down here is propagated one level higher. So you always, and at the root, you have the two best peers in the whole network, in the whole subtree, basically for you to choose. So what's the result? Yeah, the tree with very strong peers. And the best trees are at the top, carrying most of the load, and no peers overloaded. And if still some peers overloaded, you can be sure that there's no better peer in your position than you or your support peer, and you just can consider your maximum load and drop the rest. So here you see the example. So this is the maximum number of entries the peer is able to carry, and the children nodes tell, okay, I have, they start with a small value, let's say 50 entries, 50 peers, and say I have further 450, it should be, and that's also not correct, should be 700, and this is, but they are exceeding the 200 of this peer. So the peer is taking a support peer, which is very powerful, can take 4000, and they accept it. And next it will answer to its children nodes where to send the peer entry. So it is able to take 80 of the entries, and 420 should be sent to the support peer, and similarly for the second peer. And the next time, so the stream is split up, but and all of the entries from below can be handled, and yeah, that's how it works. The good thing is that there are never more than, so there's always the coordinator and maximum one support peer, so it's never more. And if you're looking for some specific peer, so let's say I'm peer P and I'm looking for 7 peers with this capacity requirements, then this is the way how the query goes. So it always goes to the parent peer, and then to the support peer, then again to its parent peer, again to a support peer, and they just append the peers that are fitting, and the last that has a that found the last of the search peers is replying back. So this is how the querying works, and with this approach, I think yes. So that's this is how peers with given capacities can be found in the peer-to-peer network. There might be also better approaches, but it's still a very useful function that has been also simulated, but it's not in the peer-to-peer framework. And to wrap up, so to have the final topic discussed, which is also very important for us, are the evaluation approaches that are relevant for this peer-to-peer framework. Because, so why is evaluation important? So basically, if you do not have, so if you create some algorithm, you have some protocol, you implement it in the peer-to-peer framework, if it's not evaluated, if there are no numbers or graphs showing how good it is for this protocol, then it has to be assumed that it's bad. Because you do not know so how the performance is, you need reliable numbers, and that's why evaluation is always important. And it's also very important just to underline the quality of your research work and of your design. So how can we evaluate in the peer-to-peer framework, in this PG? There are different approaches. I just want to give an overview. Analysis is one approach, but we cannot follow it. So this the analysis would be to prove the performance bounds and complexities. That's quite good, but not applicable for us. Simulation would be to have a fake, so you have a simulator, you implement your mechanisms in it, and you have a model for the network, model for the users, you have controlled actions, and you see how your performance, how your mechanism, your protocol behaves under this model of users, model of network, and you can say something about the quality of it. Emulation. So this is also not the case what we do, because simulations are often in one piece of code, very optimized, so that you really can run 10,000 nodes on one machine. And the peer-to-peer framework is not optimized to do so. So you can run 30 nodes on one machine. Some probably also 50, but not really more. So then the resources are consumed and used up. Emulation can be done, but probably also not for us, but that we will have could check. So the idea is that you have let's say, if you take the pool PCs, there are 20, 30 PCs, and if you would run the software, the peer-to-peer framework on top of it, then of course the delay between the devices are 5 milliseconds or 2 milliseconds, because they are directly connected via a switch. And with an emulation that you would put instead of the switch, so you would connect the pooled PC devices to an emulated network that introduces a correct amount of delay and correct amount of bandwidth limitations and correct amount of loss. So it would emulate the network, but you would have the real code. So you still have instances of on real PCs, on few devices, but they behave with each other realistically because the network is emulated. And alpha and beta tests, so that would be some goals for this PG, to really introduce, to have real code, a real network, so to use the peer-to-peer framework over the real internet, but fake users, that means friendly PG members that do not try to attack the network. So you have a controlled user environment. We can ask each other to follow a specific user protocol to test how it behaves, how it works. So the users are fake because they are friendly. And a beta test that would require to really take the code, put it in the internet, ask 1,000 or 100 people to use it, and to hope for the best. So very hostile. If you ask 1,000 people, let's say 20 or 50 will be malicious. They try to destroy your network. So everything is possible, and that's why it's also most useful results. And these two aspects are basically what we can aim for. So how can this be done? First of all, testbed-based evaluation. So this is if we are very friendly and we do not test it first on the internet, but only here on the pool PCs. So how it could look like is, for example, what we did once to take 37 PCs, we've run several instances on them to have 500 peers, and that's how it looked like. That was the pool PC somewhere else, and we ran all the code and tested it, and it was quite interesting to see what really happens if you turn off one half of the PCs. And this, does the replication work? What is the delay? How does it really work? And this is something that we also can start with, to use the pool PC up here to test it on 30 PCs to see how it behaves. Also try to have not 500 peers, probably can also make 1,000 peers because we are more people. We can also then extend to have some of the peers in the internet, and that's how it typically begins slowly to evaluate in such a test bed. So yeah, that's what you can test. What if 10, 20, or 50% of the nodes leave, or there's random churn, and you can generate some statistics. Yes, that's for example what we did. So the green line, that's how the number of peers should have behaved. So this is the number of peers, and this is what we, by running around switching off peers, were trying to do, and to monitor whether the correct number of peers is monitored. And as you see, the network is still connected even if 50% of the nodes go offline. Everything was working fine. And we could also, so that gives you just the opportunity to gather statistics on the running system, for example, also on the bandwidth utilization, and how the peers are located, and this and that. Some new thing that I want to add to this is, here we were running around like crazy to have a strict timeline when we have to switch on PCs and switch them off. That was very manual. With the last PG, what they also did is a test plugin that enables you to coordinate the actions of all of those peers from one PC on. So you have a action script basically, and all of the peers, so all 500 peers would now be able to register for that server to say and to accept commands, and the server would then send out which actions. So let's say 10, all of the peers should perform some friend request or look up some photo albums, or to coordinate really the actions, so that now you do not have to run around. Okay, and so what can be done beyond this local testbed is to test in a large scale with there's a so-called Planet Lab, which is the biggest testing network worldwide. That's a that's a community of, I'm not sure how many universities, around 500, 700 universities. They all give one or two PCs or devices, connect them, and there you have the Planet Lab, and you can request to get access to it. And then you can upload your code, your program, to all of those 1,000 PCs and try it out. That's also the reason you have up to 20 programs running in parallel. Nodes are overloaded, but at least you have really a high number of nodes, and they are you can also control them, so you still have the fake users, no malicious nodes are involved, and you can test how it works with 1,000 real PCs. That's basically the large scale test bed. And after this, so the test beds, that's always assumed that you have control over it, both on the devices, also on the users. The next is the alpha test. So there you really take the code, have a closed user group, that's for example the PG, and you agree on what should be tested, and they are all friendly, and they protocol the bugs and inconveniences and feature requests, and that helps to create a stable version and to debug and then to have a running version. And how can it be done? Of course, you can also ask your friends, and The monitoring is integrated. Typically, there's also a questionnaire at the end asking you what did you like, where do you see some problems, what should be improved. And typically, the users, because it's a controlled user group, also participate. For the beta test, that's basically the biggest problem and the toughest to do. There you have public user group, people whom you don't know. The only thing you can do is to limit the number of them to, let's say, 1,000 or 200. They're very picky and they very evil, and that's really the final approach how to test it. You can. That's why the monitoring is also essential to be integrated, because then you can see what's happening, what the people do, and it really helps to create final version to give free. Yeah, what are the challenges to really attract many users? If you want to have 100, then you can assume that, let's say, half of them do not like the graphical user interface or the installation procedure and they quit. So you really need many users, very attractive application to attract them. The devices are different, usage patterns are different, so very you do not know what will happen. That's why monitoring is needed. It's also integrated. It's also difficult to you do not have control on the usage anymore. You cannot update the code if there's a bug. So in the worst case, you have to ask all the users to reinstall their software. They will try to attack the protocols. They will try to find some loopholes or some attackable points, and they will misuse it. They will upload illegal content. They will try to kill the user. They will try to ping of death is something. So that was once in an application. You can send a specific message, and then the application on the receiver side shuts down. So they try to. So it's very critical, but at the end, it's very essential, because that's what we do. So we do not do the research and all these aspects for having it in a folder or to leave it, but you want to have it used. And with testing, you find out where the weaknesses are, and you can also not just measure, but you can evaluate. You can somehow underline the quality of your work with numbers, and that's what makes research research.